whole of human race, the first man on the moon. But friends, it is what President Nixon said about this momentous event that I find historically inaccurate and short-sighted. President Nixon declared, "The greatest event in human history is when man put his feet on the moon." Well, with all due respect to the President of the United States, the greatest event in human history is not what happened more than 5 decades ago when man put his feet on the moon, but what happened more than 2,000 years ago when God became man and put his feet on the earth. That, my friends, is the greatest event in human history, when God stepped out of heaven and walked on planet earth. That's what theologians call the incarnation, and that's what we ordinary people today call Christmas. Now, there are many people today, not just President Nixon, who do not recognize the true significance of the Christmas event. In fact, there are others who dismiss it as just another sentimental legend. Friends, nothing can be farther from the truth. The very first recorded Christmas celebration happened on December 25, 336 AD in Rome, when it was cool to be a Christian, because the emperor of the Roman Empire, Constantine, claimed to be a Christian himself. But now, friends, remember that for the first 300 years, Christianity was the most hated, the most persecuted, illegal religion in the empire. It just started as an underground movement with 120 disciples who locked themselves inside an upper room in Jerusalem. But through personal witness and the preaching of the word, conversions were happening person to person, family to family, community to community, until eventually the message of the cross overran the mighty Roman Empire. And today, more than 2 billion people on planet Earth claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. Friends, there's no legend that can make such an impact, especially when you consider the many lives that have been transformed from alcoholics to drug addicts, from adulterers to murderers, from a terrorist to a gang leader, from a mafia boss to a Hell's Angel member. People's lives are being changed by the message of the cross. And many of you here this afternoon had a personal encounter. And this is just what? A sentimental legend? Friends, the greatest event in human history is when God became man and put his feet on the earth. But what many people do not realize is that this greatest event is actually a fulfillment of a prophecy. In fact, the very first prophecy that you'll find in the whole of the Bible that God himself uttered about 4,000 years before the first Christmas. And so here in Genesis 3:15, you have what is called the proto-evangel, the very first gospel. And it reads, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." This prophecy will explain what Christmas really is all about. This prophecy will tell us the need for his birth, the nature of his birth, and the name at his birth. Let's look at the first one, the need for his birth. The need. What is this Christmas all about? Why do we need this? Well, that prophecy is actually in the context of judgment that was being pronounced by God upon the serpent, upon Adam and Eve after they fell into sin. But embedded in this judgment is God's mercy. There's a prophecy as to how God is going to redeem man from the clutches of sin and defeat Satan for good. There's going to be this seed of a woman. And so this seed of a woman, friends, We need to realize that the birth of Jesus Christ and therefore the celebration of Christmas itself would be completely unnecessary were it not for sin. Yes, Jesus is the reason for the season, but friends, ultimately, it's because of sin that we have this season. The black sin of mankind is the backdrop against which the first glorious light of Christmas came about. Friends, we can never understand the full significance of Christmas until we understand the depth of the problem of sin in the heart of man. And yet our society today is trying to convince us that there's no such thing as sin. You know, they say that this propensity to evil is just an ugly bump on man's road to evolution. To do away with sin, they use euphemistic terms like an aberration, or they call it a disease, to convince us that we are not sinful, we are just sick. You hear this in courtrooms, you hear this in counseling rooms, you hear this in clinics, even in the movies. And why is that, you might ask? Why do I not want to deal with this sin? Well, friends, to view it as sin is considered a Christian imposition upon our freedom. Psychologists, as early as the 50s and the 60s, they tried to find other descriptions regarding this raging battle from within. And by their humanistic trivializing of wrongdoing, we now have the excuse of being sick rather than being sinful. I'd like you to listen to the surprising words from a secular atheistic psychologist, Professor Hobart Maurer. He was one time professor at Yale, one time professor at Harvard, one time president of the American Psychological Association. In 1960, he wrote an article in the American Psychologist for everybody to read. And here are the words that he wrote. Please listen very carefully. He said, "For decades, we psychologists look upon the whole matter of sin and moral accountability as a great incubus and acclaim our liberation from it as epoch-making. But at length, we have discovered that to be free in this sense, that is to have the excuse of being sick rather than sinful, is to court the danger of also becoming lost. This danger is, I believe, betokened by the widespread interest in existentialism, which we are presently witnessing. In becoming amoral, ethically neutral and free, we have cut the very roots of our being, lost our deepest sense of selfhood and identity, and with neurotics themselves, we find ourselves asking, who am I? What is my deepest destiny? What does living really mean?" Wow! Words coming from a secular, atheistic psychologist who would not give any credence to the Bible to make such a statement in a public forum. Professor Hobart Maurer died in 1982 at the age of 75 by committing suicide. Friends, when a psychologist commits suicide, you know we're in deep trouble. By the way, do you know the suicide rate right now here in Canada? I just Googled it yesterday, and this is from the government statistics. And they tell us that at least 10 Canadians commit suicide every single day. 10, at least 10, they said. 10 Canadians commit suicide every single day. Right now, the number two cause of death among the youth, ages 15 to 24, is suicide. I have a friend who drives one of our TTC subway trains, and he said, "Pastor Roy, we average one jumper a week." Really? One jumper a week? Somebody who jumps into the railway tracks to commit suicide? How can that happen in a first-class city like Toronto? 10 Canadians every day committing suicide. How can that happen in a first-world country like Canada? How? Well, friends, the Bible makes it very clear that the ultimate problem in your heart and in my heart is neither physical nor intellectual, it is deeply spiritual. And yet people today would have us believe that the cure to the problem of sin is simply economic progress. that the only people will be economically progressive that we eradicate criminality. That it's because of poverty, because their stomachs are empty, and that's why people are driven to criminal activities. Well, friends, listen to me very carefully. Time and time and time again, we learn in history that some of the most heinous crimes perpetrated against humanity have not come from men and women whose stomachs are empty, but it came from men and women whose stomachs are full. Some would have us believe that if only people will get education, then we eradicate ignorance, and that's what will free us from doing harmful things against each other. Friends, again we read from history that some of the vilest acts of criminality done against humanity did not come from people who are uneducated and bereft of understanding, but have come from those who have access to the greatest amount of learning. Take, for example, the life of Joseph Stalin, who exterminated 15 million of his own people. Did you know that Stalin was once a seminary student preparing to serve God, and then he turned his back against God to seek this power to rule this vast empire? Friends, the Bible states it in no uncertain terms that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately corrupt. So here in Genesis 3:15 makes it very clear, friends, that sin is the poison of satanic origin that has infected the bloodstream of the whole human race. And so first of all, it shows us the need for his birth. God had to come, be born of a woman, to save you and me from our sins. Why? Because better economy cannot save us from our sins. Higher education cannot save us from our sins. Scientific advancement cannot save us from our sins. Best government cannot save us from our sins. Friends, the greatest event in human history is when God became man and put his feet on the earth to save us from our sins. But now secondly, here in Genesis 3:15, we see the nature of his birth. You know the phrase, her seed is very interesting, or the seed of the woman. Because both the Hebrew word that was used and the translation into Greek, both of them refer to the sperm of the woman. That's the literal translation. Her seed, it refers to her sperm. Now we all know there's no such thing, because biology tells us that it's the sperm of the man that fertilizes the egg of the woman. So this prophecy hints that Christmas is about a supernatural birth. Now the prophecy here in Genesis 3:15 is reiterated in Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14, where it says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel." You see, what lifted Christmas out of the ordinary was that the conception of Mary was without the help of a man. The virgin birth, or to be more accurate, the virgin conception, has never happened before. Even the cases we find in the Bible, the case that of Sarah, the mother of Isaac, and the case of Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, yes, God did the extraordinary in its case because they were barren, and then God made them pregnant at a very old age. Now that's a miracle in itself. I mean, how old was Sarah when she got pregnant with Isaac? She was 91 years old. Can you imagine a 91-year-old woman being wheeled into the delivery room? Wow! That would be headline news on CP24. But I think the police, well, will be looking for that merciless man who did this. But friends, it's nothing compared to what happened to the Virgin Mary. You see, in the case of Sarah and Elizabeth, they conceived with the help of their husbands. But not with Mary. The angel said that it will be by the power of the Holy Spirit that she will bear a son. And friends, this is the first time this has ever happened. In July 1978, a little girl named Louise Brown was born in England. At 5 pounds, 12 ounces, Louise was a tiny baby. But what made her true, what made her birth truly extraordinary was that she was the first baby ever born who was conceived outside the human body. Little Louis Brown was the first test tube baby. Well, this birth is extraordinary indeed, but friends, this is not supernatural. You still need the sperm from the man to fertilize the egg from the woman. A test tube baby birth is nothing compared to a virgin birth. There's just nothing like it. And the prophecy says the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. Now, this is the first time this has ever happened, a woman conceiving without the help of a man. Of course, today, there are scientists and doctors who would tell us that a virgin birth could happen. They say that it's a physical possibility. They call this the human parthenogenesis. In 1956, the medical journal Lancet published a report concerning 19 alleged cases of virgin birth among women in England who were studied by members of the British Medical Association. They examined these 19 claims of women to have had babies without physical relations with a man. After a battery of tests, they dismissed all but a handful few of the claims and then finally reduced it down to 2. Out of 19, only 2. The 6-month study convinced the investigators that human parthenogenesis was physiologically possible and had actually occurred in 2 of the women studied. And in these 2 rare cases, doctors and scientists were prepared to say that a virgin birth occurred, that the female egg or ovum within the womb had spontaneously divided by itself to form a baby. But in these few accepted cases of possible virgin birth, in each case, it's been a baby girl. You see, a woman can only produce a female egg. The female has an XX chromosome, and so if the egg will just divide by itself, it will always produce a baby girl. A woman doesn't have the capacity to produce a baby boy. It takes the Y from the male to make it into a baby boy. But Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 clearly says, he shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. Isaiah 7:14 clearly said, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. Friends, this is virgin birth, and it's a baby boy. It's a miracle. This has never happened before. This is not only a human birth, this is a divine birth. You see, Christmas is no ordinary human event. We're dealing here with the supernatural, when God became man to save us from our sins. No other fact in the Christmas story is more important than the virgin birth. The virgin birth must have happened exactly the way Scripture says. Otherwise, Christmas has no point at all. Why? Because if Jesus was only the natural son of Joseph and Mary, if it's only a human birth, then friends, Jesus cannot be God. If Jesus is not God, his claims are all lies. If his claims are lies, his salvation is a hoax. And if his salvation is a hoax, then we are all doomed. And that's why it's got to be both a human birth and a divine birth. There's only one way for that to happen. You need a human mother and a divine father. There's just no other way for it to be done. But now lastly, we need to ask the question, why did God have to go through all the hassle? Why did he have to leave his glorious abode only to come down here and be born in a stinking manger? Why does the Almighty One have to stoop down and become a tiny infant? Why does the Creator God have to clothe himself with a frail human body? Why did God have to go through all the hassle? So that you and I can exchange gifts? Certainly not. We can always do that without God becoming man. Or maybe it's so that you and I can have Christmas trees and fairy lights. I don't think so. Friends, there's only one reason why God went through all the hassle. There's only one reason why we celebrate Christmas, and that's because of the name given at his birth. The archangel Gabriel told Joseph what name to give this baby and the reason why he is to give that name. The angel Gabriel said in Matthew 1 verse 21, she will give birth to a son and you are to give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. Friends, there's only one reason why he left his glorious abode and came down here to be born in a stinking manger. There's only one reason why Creator God had to clothe himself with a frail human body. He came on that first Christmas day to save you and me from our sins. It's not about Santa Claus. It's not about Christmas trees or exchanging gifts or nice clothes and good food. Friends, we need to realize that Jesus Christ did not come here primarily to save us from our loneliness. He did not come here primarily to save us from our prostration and our discomfort. Jesus Christ did not come here primarily to save us from our poverty or our sickness and our discontent. No, friends, he came here that first Christmas for one reason and one reason alone. And that is to save you and me from our sins. But you know what the tragedy is? We want him to save us from our discomfort. We want him to save us from our boredom. We want him to save us from our poverty and our sickness. But we don't want him to save us from our sins. But Jesus came to deal with one thing and one thing only. All these other things are just the byproduct. He came to save us from our sins. That's what Christmas really is all about. Friends, God sent Jesus, his son, so he can show each one of us how you and I can be saved. Let me just close this with a story. It's a story of a family of three, the husband, his wife, and their seven-year-old son. It was Christmas Eve and the ground was covered with snow. The wife, who was a devoted Christian, was preparing to attend the Christmas Eve service and would like her husband and their son to join her. The husband, who was an unbeliever, refused to go with her plan and would not even allow their son to go with her. He argued, "It's a waste of time. It's ridiculous," he said. "Why would God, if there really is a God, come down to earth and become a man?" And so with a heavy heart, the wife went alone to think and worship God, who became man to save us from our sins. Now while the father and his son were looking through the window as the wife walked through the snow, there was this flock of birds flying furiously. The dad was explaining to his son how birds would fly south for the winter to escape the bitter cold winds in the north, so they won't freeze to death. But for some reason, these birds weren't able to fly south. The father and the son saw them fly furiously, trying to find shelter so they won't freeze to death. But they can't seem to find such a place. So the son asked the father, "Dad, is it okay if we open our house so that the birds would come in and be saved from the bitter cold?" And the father said, "Sure, son." So the boy went outside, opened their door. He tried to signal the birds to come in. But when the birds saw the boy, they all got scared. They scattered and flew away. The boy tried whistling, throwing food in the air, but all to no avail. Frustrated and with tears flowing down his cheek, the boy went inside their house. The father put his arm around his son and said, "You know, son, we could save those birds if only I can send you to become one like them. If only you can become a bird so you can fly with them, so you can feel the cold with them, suffer with them, and then show them the way to be saved." As soon as the father said this, the church bell started ringing, and he felt a tug on his soul, for now he understood why God had to send his son to become human like us. Friends, this is what Christmas is all about. It's about the time almost 2,000 years ago when God the Father sent his son to become just like one of us. He became a man, someone who can feel the cold with us, someone who can suffer with us, someone who knows what it means to be tempted and yet did not succumb to sin, someone who knows the battles we face, the struggles we are in, someone who knows what it means to be in pain, someone who knows what it means to be treated unfairly, someone who knows what it means to be poor and to be rejected, and more important, someone who can show us the way to be saved. Friends, this is what Christmas is all about. It's about God sending His own Son to save us from our sins. Now, we don't want you to miss the real meaning of Christmas this year. Friends, that gift of God through His Son is being offered every day, not just on Christmas Day. And it's being offered to us today. November 17, 1977, when I accepted that offer to make Jesus the Lord of my life and help me overcome a life of pornography, help me overcome a life of hatred towards my mom. That gift is being offered to us today. I do not know most of you here this afternoon, but there are only two choices here. It's either you receive Christ or you reject God's offer. Friends, you can make Christmas more meaningful this year if you surrender your life to Him and tell Jesus, "Jesus, save me from my sins." Now, some of our sins are blatant. There's addiction to alcohol. There's addiction to drugs. There's addiction to sex. For some, it's hidden in our bedroom with our pornographic websites. But whatever that sin is, Jesus came for one reason and one reason alone. He came to save us from our sins. Maybe some of you here are having struggles with some messed up relationships. Maybe it's a relationship between you and your spouse. Maybe between parents and children. Maybe between you and your office mates. And you just feel that tug on your soul and you want God to help you. Friends, this is that opening this afternoon. And so with the lights on, the house lights on, those of you who feel that tug in your soul and you want to say, "Lord Jesus, I want to experience you in a personal way this Christmas. I want you to save me from my sins." If that's you, we want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. But what we'd like to do right now is just a count of three. If you want to receive Jesus into your heart, if you want to have a meaningful Christmas this year, in a count of three, just raise your hand. You don't have to be embarrassed. This is between you and God. We are all sinners here. Nobody is better than anyone here. We all need help. I received that help in 1977. You can receive that help today. In the count of three, just raise your hands if you want to have a meaningful Christmas by offering your life to Jesus Christ. 1, 2, 3.